I like being a part of that conversation about how we can enhance the environment and not just take from it.
I've been very lucky to live in a lot of different coastal environments, and all of them have their sources of joy.
I have mixed feelings about what the future is looking like right now. I think it would look better with offshore wind in the picture.
Offshore wind, it's opportunity. It's just one key piece in a puzzle that will help us address the climate crises that we're facing right now.
It's pretty incredible how resilient nature can be when we give it the opportunity to bounce back. Get out into those coastal wetlands, you realize how magnificent of an ecosystem this is. I've always loved birds. I've been bird watching ever since I can remember. Birds are an indicator of how the ecosystem is working. When birds aren't doing well, it's telling us that there's a problem in the world.
This is a place where birds land when they first come across the Gulf. They see this spot, they're exhausted, they drop down here.
We have around 7,000 pairs of birds that nest here, roughly 2,600 pairs of brown pelicans. I mean, birds are part of the coastal landscape.
There is a lot of concern about offshore wind and birds. For good reasons, you know, there can be bird strikes with wind turbines. And if we understand those impacts, we can keep coming up with new mitigation strategies. For example, there was a preliminary study that showed if you paint one of the blades black, you can reduce bird strikes by up to 72%.
If you place wind turbines close to shore, that's where most of the birds are. That's where the pelicans are, the migratory shorebirds. And so, you know, by placing them further offshore, it decreases the risk to a lot of those species. 2.1 billion birds cross the Gulf every spring. And so the one concern that remains are the migratory birds that are flying across the Gulf. We need to know how high these birds are flying in order to assess the risk of collisions with offshore wind. And we're gonna open up this net and set out a decoy. And hopefully that'll convince him to fly in. So now we have the net set up, we're gonna play the song of the male prothonotary warbler. So while we have a bird in hand, we're gonna try to take as much data as we can in an efficient way so we can maximize the value of taking this bird out of its world for a few minutes. All right, so he's outfitted with his geolocator. We're adding tracking devices to understand exactly how high they're flying when they're crossing the Gulf. And that'll help us inform that risk that these migratory birds are facing.
If we can engage with wind developers, we have the opportunity to develop the turbines and site them in the right ways and use research like Eric's collecting in Louisiana to come up with the best type of design for offshore Gulf wind turbines, which I think is a really exciting opportunity to be at the forefront of that technology.
I was totally born into fishing. You know, my father, my grandfather, my great-grandfather, but they never took it to the level that I've taken it to because I've gone in the direction of conservation.
We just left Atlantic Highlands Harbor Marina. We're headed out to the end of Sandy Hook towards Brooklyn.
Right now, you can catch any one of four different species. Summer flounder or fluke down there. There's bluefish, there's striped bass. And then this year, there's croakers, which are normally south, they've come north. There's a lot of climate-related change. I've seen a lot of changes on the water. I've seen species come and go, and obviously that affects fishing, which is my way of life. But overall, a big factor here is that we continue to burn fossil fuels. I do feel as if the coast is dying a death of a thousand cuts from a thousand different directions. Thank you.
Many organizations like the Audubon Society feel that we need to move towards renewable energies. It's not only climate change. I've seen numbers that there are upwards of 2,000 oil spills in Louisiana every single year. It's contaminating our ecosystems.
At the National Aquarium, we really focus on three big goals. We're trying to combat climate change, we're trying to stop plastic pollution, and we're trying to save wildlife and habitats. This is a turtle rehabbing because it was cold stunned off of Virginia Beach and is now recuperating in our rehab facility and is about to eat its piece of squid. Marine wildlife face several threats, most of which are related to human activity. We live on a warming planet, and that is causing changes to how animals and people live our lives. Their migratory patterns are changing, their food availability is changing. And so, in order to combat climate change and to have a livable, relatively comfortable planet, we need to move off of fossil fuels.
Wow. To me, protecting the coast, I'll get all choked up when I do this. I guess it's just, to witness the interconnection of everything is vital, and it also makes you a much better fisherman.
Got another one right there in front of you. This is a summer flounder. He's a little short, but cute. So from nose, he's just short, he's 16 and a half. So he goes spree.
Offshore wind, to me, clearly is the answer. Each tower and each foundation would become a literal fish factory. Any fisherman knows about structure. We know if there's structure, there's fish that live there. And to me, when you're adding 100 little reefs in a row, a mile apart, I mean, it's not gonna get any better than that. It would create new habitat, and it would just be a boom for the coastal economy.
The ambitions for offshore wind in California are tremendous. Already, the state is planning for offshore wind to be potentially up to 25% of the state's overall power. 25 million homes can be powered by this enormous, large-scale clean energy source. Brightline really wants to ensure three different things happening with offshore wind. We want to make sure that capacity is built up so local communities can engage in this. Two, we want to make sure that energy is affordable. Third and finally, we want to make sure that local economies and local jobs are being built up as a result of something like offshore wind. For Brightline's work, which typically serves the most underserved communities, communities that often feel left behind, we tried to focus on their needs. A lot of the work, I think, is about making sure that we have environmental monitoring and siting processes underway that can reassure local communities so that ultimately there is community buy-in for something like a clean energy project.
Marine renewable energy is an incredible opportunity. It also brings challenges. What we can help with is the information part. The first step is just getting data. The base platform collects waves, winds, currents, barometric pressure, water temperature, underwater sound to understand what the impact of building is on ecosystems that could be sensitive. During construction, if there is a mammal or a vessel nearby, potentially to halt construction if necessary to limit the impacts on the ecosystem. Every sensor is operated and owned by a local group of people, and that's what makes it work. We work with the entire ocean community together to create a technology that everybody benefits from.
Their ability to look at environmental data to site offshore wind responsibly is a key piece of making sure that local communities can be comfortable with something like offshore wind in the future. Our attitude is not just to put up offshore wind all the time, it's really to create processes that make offshore wind more equitable ultimately for local communities.
In the short term, I think we're hopeful to see our energy sector diversified. We'll bring new jobs, it'll bring opportunities. All energy infrastructure has the potential to negatively impact wildlife, and offshore wind is no exception to that. However, we can find places to responsibly site offshore wind to minimize its impacts.
In a world that's shifting and changing, it's easy to kind of step back and be overwhelmed by the size of the problems, but I think there's more power in solutions.
I believe that fishing and offshore wind can totally coexist.
I feel very positive about responsible offshore wind development as an energy source that can, you know, allow us to live on this ocean planet that we love.
My biggest hope is ultimately that we build these projects responsibly in a way that local communities can take a lot of pride in and ultimately feel like they're contributing to the world and making it a better place.